You often say that you have siblings from the same litter is a recipe for trouble. Can you explain why?
This is the thing. Oh, shit. I jumped on to David's question. I don't know why. So this is the thing. You could make, all depends on your skills. I'm a huge advocate of people not getting two puppies at once, just in general. Why? It's a fucking shit show. Raising one puppy is hard. Raising two, even if you got a 9-week-old puppy and a 10-week-old puppy, totally different breeds from totally different parts of the world and brought them in your house, it's still a shit show at your house. Even the best dog trainers are like, what the fuck did I get myself into? And you got, that's especially if you've got a life. You know, if you had a dog training facility, it's no big deal. But if you actually have a life, getting two dogs from the same litter, what they could do is they could end up possibly struggling with a lot of separation anxiety issues. If you don't put enough structure into their life and you actually separate them. A lot of people want to keep them together all the time. The problem is that can work against you big time, big time. Next. We got a live show right now. Are we live? We're live. Hello, anybody home? Hey, everybody, how are you? Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. It is Wednesday night. Wednesday night, a little bit after 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It's the What Would Jeff Do show. Thank you so much. We're streaming live on YouTube for all the folks that are all on our voice platforms like SoundCloud, on Spotify, on iHeartRadio, on Google, on Alexa. Thank you so much for listening. If you're live, you get to ask questions right down at the bottom there where it says say something. You can type in your questions. If you're not familiar with us and what we do, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I've got a board and train and dog training facility up in Providence, Rhode Island. I personally travel the world doing seminars. We've got about 20 scheduled for 2019. You can go to Jeff Gellman Seminars, jeffgellmanseminars.com. This is Joelle. She's one of the trainers there. She actually does the seminars with me as well. She documents the whole road trip and then documents the seminar. We specialize in stopping unwanted behaviors. We're really good with aggression, leash reactivity, anxiety, some pretty unwanted behaviors that people really want. We tend to be sometimes people's last choice of dog trainers. We have a ton of free information out there, lots of different platforms, YouTube Live being one of them. We do Facebook, we Instagram stories, we do Patreon, a lot of ways to get free information. And then obviously for folks that need a lot more help, we have got Skype, we've got seminars, and we've got the board and train business and one-on-one. This show though tends to be more of how do I stop? Most people actually always ask me how to stop things. I don't get too many like, how do I train my dog to do sit? There's about 1,000, 10,000 videos out there on how to train sit. I don't really care how you do it. You can do it a ton of different ways. But stopping unwanted behaviors, most dog trainers actually can't do. They don't do. They don't want to do. They don't know how to do. So you'll find that you'll always often hear me talk about punishment. Now, punishment is not bad. It's not evil. It's not abusive. A couple of rules for punishment. You're not mad. You're not upset. You're not angry. It's just a matter of fact. You can't do that. I don't agree with it. You're not like saying bad dog and sending them to their crate, that's not proper punishment. It's usually a 1 to 3 second consequence. It should be uncomfortable. The dog should not want to do it again. And now you have to learn how to properly do it. So most of my conversations and answers are based on punishment, but you have to put my advice on this show into the full spectrum of dog training, which is based on training your dog awesome stuff, which is all done through rewards. We actually use food and clickers and high value food and praise. Once in a while, we'll use a toy, but we also are big on nutrition. Personally, most of us feed raw. You don't have to feed raw. We're huge on exercise. But the show is always, how do I stop? How do I stop? How do I stop? Life is short. I need to give an answer. A lot of unethics go on in dog training. I tend to call it out. I never mention names. I find that unethical to mention names of other dog trainers. And people try to bait me, and that's just not going to work. So Joelle is going to start asking questions right about
now.
Now.
Michael, I'm sure you've never had to deal with clients like this, but how would you handle owners not showing up for any of the lessons with the dog before the end of the board and train?
What?
And what more can I do to prevent working with clients like this again? I do as much screening as I can. I really thought these clients would be different. Thanks.
Well, yeah, we always have a client that slips through the cracks. And you know, I've talked to a lot of people. I've worked with thousands and thousands of clients and then talk to tens of thousands of people. So I'm pretty good at the people aspect of it. In fact, this job is the people aspect. We're in the people business, not the dog business, actually. If you don't like people, don't own a dog training business. You can still be a dog trainer, but work for someone else and just don't deal with the public. Just work with dogs. But you need to be a people person. Did they know that they were supposed to be doing these appointments? Number two, if they knew they were supposed to be doing these training appointments and they're not doing them, all you can do is type up a letter. And I'm not big on like typing up letters at all. It's just like, you decided not to participate in any of the training. So I can't pass on any of the information to you in a timely fashion. Here's a good luck, I guess. I mean, a boarding train is not supposed to be, here's your dog, good luck. I mean, we do 6 hours of training with a client after a boarding train, one-on-one. I mean, we take them step by step. We give them all kinds of videos and written information, and we do phone stuff and email, and we give 6 hours of hands-on. I mean, that is the most important part. If they fail to participate in that, everybody sort of shit out of luck on that, but you know, you can always break your rules too and see maybe there's something going on. Maybe something's going on. Ask questions next. But yes, has it happened? Of course it has. If it's happened to you, it's probably happened to us. Next.
Crescent Moon Girl. Hi, we recently took in my brother's dog. He's a sweet 4-year-old pit bull. He loves other dogs and gets on well with our Great Dane puppy. But the puppy picks constantly with him, always jumping and nipping him to the point he snaps at him. I don't want to fight, so how do I teach the puppy not to be such an obnoxious idiot? They play just fine, but the pup always takes it too far.
So it's your job to advocate for both dogs. The other dog, not because it's a pit, but any dog, like my dog, would probably do that after the second time. Because my dog doesn't put up with bullshit. So it's your job. You know it's wrong. It's your job to step in and advocate for both dogs. Or else your other dog is going to say, nobody's going to help me here. I'll just do it the old-fashioned way. Like the way genetically I'm designed to do. And that's to stop this pain in the ass puppy. And how do we stop things? We use our mouths. That's what we do. And you might not like how that looks. And the puppy is going to be scared shitless. Now, if you've got a really good puppy raiser, I owned one. Her name was Uma. I would let Uma do the job, and she was great at it. But most dogs aren't good puppy raisers. So what do? You could, number one, your young puppy should not have free roaming. Your young puppy should have massive amounts of structure in its life, meaning sleeps in a crate, meaning it's in a crate when you're not home, meaning there is downtime, not timeout, but actual downtime. You should be training your dog on all its obedience commands. And then you should be supervising play. So when the dog gets too rough, the dog can be dragging a leash. You would say no, and then you can pop the leash and to stop the dog. You can de-escalate the dog. So you have to be able to make sure you advocate for the other dog. This concept that all dogs should put up with everything is total bullshit. Next.
Sammy, if properly matched, do you think that Vizslas and Malinois can make good service dogs?
All depends on what they need to do. I mean, I imagine somewhere they are. That's not your typical service dog candidate, but I don't know. Is it medical alert? Is it for like, you know, I don't know. I mean, what is it for? And it's not as much necessarily breed as it is about the training behind it and probably the temperament of the dog. Like the temperament of the dog has a lot to do with it. I mean, certain breeds are better for like, you know, for literally like, you know, support, you know, balance support, you know, that's important. Oh, by the way, there's a little dollar sign down at the bottom, dollar, dollar, make you holla. It's called Super Chat. And you can hit that button and you can actually throw us some money. Your question goes up to the top. We do try to get through all the questions, but a lot of times in the 90 minutes we have allotted, we don't get through all the questions. So you get your question right up to the top. And then I'll answer it. And also, if you've been benefiting from all of our free content throughout the years with thousands of videos, you might be like, you know what? It's worth $5. Next.
Lou, when do you choose to use a dominant dog collar over a prong on a reactive dog? Mm. Do you have a how-to video? Why both slip and e-collar?
Actually, here's a great – so today, Logan – Logan tends to sometimes, Logan is that German Shepherd. He's highly leash reactive. We've been showcasing him on a couple of different lives and on some social media platforms that we have. We did a Facebook live of him today, I believe. And He's very reactive on walks still. He's only been with us for, you know, a little bit over a week. So he still struggles on walks. He does really great on his walks now. But now when he sees a dog, he's still escalating. He's going to be moved over to a dominant dog collar. A dominant dog collar tends to de-escalate the arousal quick. So he'll be on the dominant dog collar, remote collar combo. Prong collars sometimes don't, and a lot of times can actually escalate it. It doesn't make the dog aggressive, but it definitely can escalate the arousal on some dogs. Most dogs, it doesn't. As far as a slip lead, we historically don't use slip leads off property. We historically don't use slip, but we could. Like, all of us can train a dog on a slip lead. Like, most dog trainers can train dogs on slip leads, but they're not practical for owners. So we train for owners. So owners with slip leads usually doesn't work. It usually doesn't work. So we can do it for some dog training protocols in the training center, but we train dogs on tools because that's the best thing for the owner to use. Next. And no, there's no video. We don't have a video on it. Next.
Michael, if you only had 1 hour to work with the owners and their dog after a board and train, what would be the most important things to work through out of state owners with a human aggressive dog?
Oh, you're fucked, Michael. You're truly fucked. And, you know, I mean, that's like, what would you do? I would start at the very beginning of the basics, like you do. I don't know how many hours you normally do, but say if you do 4 hours, they get the first hour. And then they miss the other 3 hours, I guess. I mean, oh no, the customer's always right. No. They brought you a human aggressive dog. You'd think they'd be more invested in it. So we can't care more than the owner cares, ever. It's not our dog. And all that always sounds cold and uncaring, but it's like theoretically, guys, we're hired help. Like, it's your dog. And I love my owners. I love them to death. I will go to the end of the world for them. But they need to work harder than me, you know, because it's their dog. Now, we do all the hard work at first, but that commitment needs to be there. It needs to be there. But there could have been miscommunication. Michael, the first thing I would look is I always take 100% responsibility for everything that goes wrong in my life. My life. I had a little employee meeting today. Guess what? I could have blamed all my staff. I could have blamed all my staff for these issues. Guess who I blamed? Me. And theoretically, I wasn't even there. It doesn't matter. It's my fucking company. It comes down to me. Everything in my life is my fault. So, Michael, own this. Make it work. But figure things out, though. Figure things out. But if they're like, oh, no, we only can stay for an hour, say, okay, I'll just teach you the first hour then. And they're like, well, how about everything else? We don't have time for that. All right, next.
Ryan, when putting an e-collar or prong collar on my dog, he becomes anxious. He will put his mouth around my wrist, come out of his sit, or just be unruly. Nothing over the top, but annoying nonetheless. Any advice? Welcome.
Yeah, he's just being a pain in the ass. He's a dog. He's just being a dog. That's all. Okay. A lot of folks will say, well, it's the prong collars because it hurts. Really? Have you ever put a fucking gentle leader on a dog? My God. It's like a bucking bronco. Have you ever put like a martingale, a muzzle, like try to clip a dog's nails? Like, they're dogs. That's your dog objecting. Literally, that's your dog saying no. What do? You just tell the dog, eh, you're going to have to get over it because this is the way it's going to work, right? Because if we have that, they'll do that with everything. They'll do it with everything. Put a martingale, a flat buckle collar, a slip lead on a dog. They'll do it with everything. I remember once I had a dog that never had any collar on it at all. It was a, oh my God, I don't know. It was some bully breed that was, it had greyhound something in it, but it was huge. It was a bully. It was a huge, I don't know, great, it was a big dog, 90 pounds. It never had a collar on. We put a flat buckle collar on it, attached a leash to it. It's like it was, you might as well have been putting a hot poker up the dog's ass. So it's easy to say it's the prong collar. It's like, no, it's just the dog objecting. It's the dog objecting. Next.
Top chat.
Looks like a David Smith top chat. Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, Festivus, etc. Demo.
Love it.
Rocky was walking with shoulder in line with knee instead of head. Few days since walk, so no big fucking deal. Awesome, David. Proud of you, buddy. Next.
The dedicated dog. Hello. Hope you had a great holiday with your family. So sorry to hear about Ronan.
Yeah, that sucks.
You often say that you have siblings from the same litter is a recipe for trouble. Can you explain why?
This is the thing. Oh, shit. Jumped on to David's question. I don't know why. So this is the thing. You could make, all depends on your skills. I'm a huge advocate of people not getting two puppies at once, just in general. Why? It's a fucking shit show. Raising one puppy is hard. Raising two, even if you got a 9-week-old puppy and a 10-week-old puppy, totally different breeds from totally different parts of the world and brought them in your house, it's still a shit show at your house. Even the best dog trainers are like, what the fuck did I get myself into? And you got, that's especially if you've got a life. You know, if you had a dog training facility, it's no big deal. But if you actually have a life, getting two dogs from the same litter, what they could do is they could end up possibly struggling with a lot of separation anxiety issues. If you don't put enough structure into their life and you actually separate them, a lot of people want to keep them together all the time. The problem is that can work against you big time, big time. Next.
Vega, I've been using the e-collar to correct my dog when he growls when I touch the cage or put my hand inside, but it doesn't seem to stop him from doing so because he still does and seems to get worse. I'm correcting him really high as the reaction is vocal. What should I do?
Well, there's a lot of different things you can do. I mean, it's not just one thing historically. There's a lot of things. What's the rest of your day look like? So are you only firm with that or are you firm with everything else? What's the training look like? Are you holding your dog accountable? Have you done come out of the kennel, go in the kennel, come out of the kennel, go in the kennel? The last thing I want people to do is blast in their dogs, right? So, you know, for certain things, sure. Getting up on the counter. Yeah. Who cares? Getting in the litter box, getting in the trash can. Doesn't matter. Let me just check to make sure these guests are, we've got guests checking into our Airbnb tonight and nope. Okay. Nothing yet. So what you're going to do is possibly the dog's going into defense. I also don't know the brand of collar you're doing and what your timing is. Put a leash on the dog, have the dog come out, have the dog go back in, have the dog, and then open up the door, close the door, open up the door, close the door, open up the door, call the dog out, have the dog coming in, turning it into a training protocol. And whenever you're about to apply a punisher, it would be, if you're there, it's no, and then correct. Next.
Allie Wynn. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Really love the live videos of Logan socializing.
Awesome. Yeah, that was great. That was today. Yep. Awesome. Glad you were there, Allie. Proud of you. Thanks for sending us that video, that update.
Yeah.
Super cool. Awesome. Yep.
Amanda, how important is it for the dog not to pass your leg when doing a controlled walk? My dog constantly has her nose head right in front of my leg when walking.
Personally, it's up to you. If your dog's not leash reactive, who gives a shit, right? If your dog doesn't pull, who cares? Next.
Kathleen. Hi, Jeff. Which recall collar do you think is the best? I have a husky shepherd mix, highly energetic dog at a dog park, and she runs around like crazy, but she does come and check in periodically.
Okay. First thing, I'm not a big fan of dog parks, but you didn't ask me about that, but I'll just throw it out there. It's not a recall collar. The shock collars are used for a lot of things, but you absolutely can use them for recall. So I can't imagine not using one for recall, but I wouldn't train the dog in the dog park on it. I would train the dog out of the dog park, and I would train the dog, make sure the dog has been trained around distractions before you use it at the dog park. So what I would do is get a e-collar technology. You can get the mini educator, but I would get the thick fur contact points because fit is everything. You need to have fit. Next. And then there's a ton of free videos online to learn how to use it.
Erin. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. So sorry to hear about Ronan's passing.
Oh, thank you so much, Erin. Yep, our family's definitely taking it hard. Next.
Christine. When working on down, my dog nips at my feet, then chews the leash. How do I get him to not nip my feet and then not chew his leash?
That's just
8-month Belgian Malinois.
You got a Malinois? Well, okay. So you got a Malinois. Definitely should want to have get a trainer close by to you that understands that. Usually most breeds I don't give a shit about, but a Malinois, that's a special breed. A lot of people are getting Malinois now and they need a lot of help. So what I would do is I would say no and then bonk, no, and then bonk. This is a bonker. It's a towel. We talk about bonkers all the time. Sometimes dogs go into defense, so you have to figure that out. You can also have, believe it or not, what we would do is a great, here's a quick, I usually don't give out tips. Here's a little tip. You take a stockyard whip. Oh my God, Jeff's going to recommend whipping a dog. It's like, no, I'm going to recommend you not getting your feet bit off right now and some nibbling turning into something worse. And if you don't control of your Malinois in 8 months, you're going to be up shit's creek because it's a Malinois. What you do is have somebody get a stockyard whip, go to Tractor Supply. So it's a 42-inch, you know, to 50-inch whip. I like the ones with a little bit of a 6-inch drop. So it's like, you know, it's a, look it up. It's all my horse people know what it is. You guys use lunge whips and dressage whips, and this is a little bit different, but it's all used in the barn area. And have somebody, if the dog's on your left-hand side, you have somebody standing farther away on your left-hand side. And as soon as that dog nibbles on your feet, you say no, and they just give a quick swat to the rear end. Oh my God, that's horrible. You ever seen what a Malinois can do? No, it's not horrible. It's proper. No teeth on me. Next.
Mm-hmm. Karen, hello. Hope you had a wonderful Christmas. So sorry to hear about the loss of Ronan.
Christmas was good. Thank you very much.
Melissa says, hello and good evening. Hope you had a nice holiday.
Melissa, hey, you Melissa. Too as well. Thank you.
Amanda, I want to crate my dog at night, but she would only be out for about an hour between waking and me leaving for work. Is that okay? Or should I try waking up earlier so she has more time between crating?
Amanda, you can get up earlier. I'm getting up at 4. Got it? That doesn't mean you got to get up at 4, but I'm getting up at 4. So let's get up earlier. Let's get up earlier. Let's go to bed. Because if she's on a dog, I like crates because of the structure, but theoretically she's sleeping for an hour before you go to work. So don't look at it as like being in the crate. Look at it as like there's not much activity. But guess what? You have a life. You work. A lot of dog trainers will say, oh, well, you should have gotten a fish. It's like, oh, okay. I'll just take this dog down to the fucking shelter and let them kill that one too. Like, no, but make it work. Get up a little bit earlier. Next.
Karen. When daughter came home and opened the door, my 7-month-old retriever ran out into the street. We hit e-collar on high, but it didn't work. How do you train for the situation?
Don't do that. The dog will run farther away. Okay? Have you trained your dog recall in drive before? No. Meaning, have you trained for that situation? If you haven't trained for that situation, it's not going to work. Also, I would need to know what kind of collar it was because it does matter. And did it fit? What's the fit on it? You have to train for a dog blowing you off, getting a high-level correction, and what's it going to do? A lot of times, they don't know what to do because they're in drive and they will just keep going through it. Remember, dogs go through underground fencing on purpose multiple times, and it's much more powerful than a shock collar. They know it's going to hurt, and they still do it. Why? Because something else is on the other side. So what I would do, number one, is train your dog to never go out that front door without permission. So I would do massive threshold protocols. Next.
Grant Noble, what did you do for Christmas?
I hung out with my family, and I went out to dinner with my family. Next.
Kaylee J., saving Christmas money for seminar in April, thinking of getting a working spot. Would that be a good idea if my only issues are nervousness and whining, or would a regular ticket be better?
Kaylee J, you can get a regular ticket and you'd probably learn a shitload. You know, you'd learn a ton, but there's probably other things that you're like, there's probably, it's more than nervousness and whining. There's usually other things. Nobody's got one or two issues with their dog. Like I probably got 20 issues with my dog. So, you know, most people got a lot of issues with their dogs. So, but that's up to you. It's up to you. It's up to budget. But to get your ass there though, because you have a good time. So that's, you know, you'd learn more from a working spot, but you're still going to learn a ton at an audit spot. Next.
Melissa says 5 more videos till 500 YouTube live Q&A.
Oh, wow. And there's probably some we never documented back in the day from the radio show. Next.
CJ, happy new year. Sirius needs his nails trimmed. He pulls his paw away. What would Jeff do?
I'm not the nail trim person. That's not my level of expertise. We do that all with Clicker and Food. There are some really, really good videos online on YouTube on nail trimming. people way, way, way above my skill set on that. Next.
Michelle says party on the 500th.
Sure. Go ahead.
Paige, my fiance and I have a 3.5-month-old Rottweiler. He is constantly going to the bathroom in the house. We try taking him outside with our 5-year-old pit bull and crating after accidents.
Okay. You shouldn't be crating after the accidents. Well, maybe you're crating now, but don't crate as a punishment. You know, so if you've got a 3.5-month-old Rottweiler, so that's 14 weeks old, the dog should be in a crate almost all day long. Almost. The dog should have no free roam whatsoever. Zero free roam. Get a good book on housebreaking. Get a good book on puppy raising as well. How to raise a puppy and the levels and the stages of life that the puppy goes through. But that dog should be in a crate when at night, in a crate when your eyes are off of it, in a crate to rest. It should only come out to go to the bathroom, to do some play with your other dog, but not a ton right now, to work on obedience commands. And then other than that, it goes back in the crate. It shouldn't be roaming around your house. Everything should be structured. That dog should be learning how to wait for its food or use food for training. We use food for training. Wait for its food if you want, if you're going to feed out of a bowl. Wait to come out of the crate, and that's all silent commands. Slip lead on the dog. Wait at the door. Go out to the exact same potty spot. Go potty. You can click and reward right there if you want to. And then work on all of its sit, place, recall, and down commands. And watch out for the cuddling. Don't carry this dog around. Get used to lots of different surfaces. Control its play with the other dog. But yeah, but if the dog's peeing all over the house, it's your fault. You know, own it. It's you. Where are you? Where are the owners in this mixture? So always that. Remember, they're puppies. That's like complaining that an infant shits in its diaper. You know. So that's what happens. So it's all on you. Get a good book, though, but that got you going. Next.
Janelle, do I have to have people put their dog on a schedule in order for them to have their dog act accordingly all the time? Or can the dog be out all day and still be trained properly? Thanks for the show. Thanks. Love the show.
Janelle, you can do anything you want to do. So it sounds like if you're a dog trainer, it's up to you. It's 1,000% up to you. Have your own training style. But the concept that your average family with their average dog behaving badly is going to make good choices without any management, I don't buy it. I don't buy it. Nope. I just don't buy it. Most owners are busy. They have lives. They've got kids. People forget their kids in their fucking car. People forget to feed their kids. People forget like people walk out of the house without like shoes. Like people aren't that, people don't have their shit together. So you got to give them a lot more guidance. Now it doesn't have to be forever, but with clients, the more, the better, the more structure, the better. Structure is always going to win. Next.
CJ, Sirius is my 14-month German Shepherd. You met him at the Maryland seminar.
I know who Sirius is.
You know who you are, Carol.
Carol, we did a fucking video on you. It's like the best video ever. I know. I'm still going to tell you, I'm not the nail trim guy. Like, I'm not blowing you off. Next. Yeah. Nail trimming is not my level of expertise. It's like, there's people out there that nail. Okay, I've trained thousands of dogs. There's people out there that have cut 5,000 to 10,000 dogs' nails. Those are the people you want to listen to. Next.
Goopsters, been training with e-collar. When telling my dog to heel, do I constantly press the stim until he gets into heel, or do I stop when he turns and looks my way? Because sometimes he stops midway to sniff.
That's not, you're not doing heel then. It sounds like the dog is way out in front of you. Heel is at your side, at your pace. So the dog, if anything, the dog should only be out of, position, maybe 6 to 12 inches tops. You know, the dog should be at your side, at your pace. So turning to look to you, which would imply that he's in front of you, which means he's not even close to healing. So watch our healing video without the remote collar. Just do the one without the remote collar first, and then incorporate that into with the remote.
Good night.
Good night, honey. Love you.
Good night, YouTube.
Okay, good night.
Good night, Angela.
Good night, Joel.
Good night, buddy.
Can you close the door, sweetheart? Thank you. Love you. So it sounds like the dog's not even in the heel position yet. So watch the healing video first. do that first, next. But then to answer your question, what we do is if the dog's a little bit ahead of us, we'll say heel, we push continuous and give leash guidance back. The dog becomes in a position and then we let go. That's during the training phase, next.
Lou, new puppy, how to best integrate with existing dog can coexist in same space, but when puppy wants to sniff his face, existing dog growls, is unhappy. Do we correct? Will he eventually get over it?
So Lou, the dog's not unhappy. Nope, dog's not unhappy. So the dog's being a dog. So what I would do is this. When it comes to, it all depends on your older dog's puppy raising skills. This is when growling is actually okay. The big thing is, if the bigger dog growls and the puppy goes, oh, so let me go back into my genetic bank of millions of years. That means, oh, you want me to get the fuck away from you. Okay. I'm going to just trot off. Or if the dog's like, I missed that class in utero, so remind me again what that means. And then the dog goes, chomp. And then the puppy goes, oh, I remember. And runs away. So ideally, the dog will growl, maybe give a little bit of a play bite. I actually don't mind in this situation. And the puppy goes, ah, runs off and scampers off. Now, the downside is, and let's also put everything into reference, I'm not one of those people that are like, let dogs figure it out. Like, no. I will figure it out for you because it'll be a dog fight. This is a very specific thing where it's a puppy going to an older dog out of curiosity. And then the older dog saying, you know, get out of my face. I'm tired of you right now. I'm humanizing it. And then the puppy should go, oh, I'll move away. And it might take one good snap, but it all depends on your other dog's bite inhibition. So, but I wouldn't correct the older dog for that at this point. Top chat, $5. Rick. Thanks, Rick. No question, but if you got one, let me know. Next.
Laura, could you explain how to correct and crate nonsense? Correct crate nonsense. My five-month-old GSD barks, whines, paces, and scratches himself on the crate when we leave him alone.
Okay. So first you have to do is this. You've got to first do it when you are home. So you set up a video camera. First thing I want you to do is this. Train your dog to go in the crate and lie down with a remote collar. So you got to teach. First you got to teach kennel up. Then you have to teach remote collar down. Then you've got to teach, go in the crate and lie down. Good. Now, dog's not lying down. You're in the other room. You got a video camera there. You can actually use the remote to reinforce the down. Any whining would get a correction. Any barking would get a correction. If the dog barks, I'd put a bark collar on the dog when you leave. The only way to stop barking when an owner leaves is with a bark collar. I would love to know how barking is stopped in a kennel for your average dog owner with low skill set when they're not home. Not a dog trainer, but a dog owner. Remember, I'm a pet dog trainer. And all these people out there, all these dog trainers have this advice, but it's like, that's good advice, but you've got a skill set. How does the average person do it? So the average person needs a bark collar. Now, what did people do before they had a bark collar? Believe it or not, a lot of people used to always be home. Also, we were a lot more aggressive with our dogs. We didn't put up with any bullshit at all. Also, we didn't live in tight spaces like we do now where neighbors are getting pissed off at the barking usually. You know, so that's what you do. Next.
Hey, dog. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Is there a lot of overlap between content you share in T3 and your seminars? On a tight budget and trying to decide whether to do one or both this year. Advice? Thanks.
No, it's way different. If you're on a tight budget, go to T3. I'll give you a fucking RV set. They're two separate companies, two separate businesses. So, you know, if you want to go to T3, go to T3 and I'll give you an audit ticket to one of my seminars, my RV seminar. I'll do that. Because T3 is a game changer. It's 7 days. It's a total game changer.
I'll kick your ass.
Yeah. Go do that. Like, I'll comp you a ticket to RV, but that's my gig. So Sean will have to, like, buy me dinner or something to do that.
Top chat.
Top chat. Tammy, thank you for all your helpful info. Really appreciate you. Tammy, I appreciate you too. Thanks, hon. Next.
Amanda, I noticed you use cots when training a lot. Do you have a preference between the cot and a regular dog bed for training or the dog resting in place?
The cots are more practical for us because we can hose them down. Mm-hmm. We can hose them down and we can stack them. Now, you can stack a dog bed, but you can't hose down a dog bed. Yes, you can take off the zipper. It's too much fucking laundry. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but a pet cot, hose the damn thing down, spray it with our disinfectant. It's easy peasy lemon squeezy. Next. Dogs piss on them. It's no big deal. Next.
Becca, one-year-old retriever mix is reactive on sight to toddlers, young kids. Had first experience with it tonight. I told him no and popped his prong collar. He seemed a little calmer after a few minutes. Any other advice?
Yeah, it seems like you're on the right path. I'd switch to a remote collar. It seems like you're on the right path. And for all the people that are, that go, oh, then the dog will have a negative association towards the kid. Did you fucking listen to the narrative that Becca just said? Which came first, the pop or the growl, guys? Which came first? Was anybody else listening? No. All these people are on their goddamn agendas out there, and they're like, that'll make the dog aggressive. No. Becca reacted to the dog's action. Dog growled first. Pop came second. Dog already has an association. So everyone has it. They have it backwards. So don't believe all those folks. And I just say that because people are like dogs are being killed that don't need to be killed because people are afraid of doing something because they're afraid it's going to cause a problem when in fact not doing it did cause the problem. $5. Top chat.
Top chat.
Sammy, Angelo is so cute. Vishla's guide dog. Cool. Yeah, I mean, I got to be careful about the whole guide dog thing, you know, and the whole service dog thing. Most dogs aren't temperament-wise. They're not good for it. But service dogs aren't my level of expertise. Like, I wouldn't pick out a service dog. I'll know, I know a dog that shouldn't be a service dog, but I wouldn't know a good candidate to be one. Like, I don't do, like, that's not my skill set is, like, picking out a dog candidate for that. But I can tell you who's not going to be a good one once I start seeing their behavior. That's easy. Next.
Hey, dog. Also, Joelle, your hair always looks so good.
I know.
You too, Jeff.
No, don't worry about me. You don't have to double compliment.
Thank you.
You don't have to double compliment. You can give all the compliments to her. In fact,
I washed it last night.
In fact, you just devalued her compliment, hey, dog. So, no tips for everybody. If you're going to compliment her, don't compliment me in the same compliments, okay? You got to give it 100% to her. Next. Now, if you want to compliment me, that's fine. But you still got to give her a side. You still got to give her a side compliment. Okay. Next.
Alvin. Hi. You emphasize using the e-collar. If a dog is showing unwanted aggression and the vibrate button on the mini educator snaps him out of it, I normally train with stim. What do you think about this?
I think if it works for you, do it. But we don't use stim. I mean, we don't use vibrates. But we're not trying to snap a dog out of it. We're trying to punish an unwanted behavior. Now, can it be a punishment? If the dog stops it and doesn't do it again, it's a punishment. If it works for you, keep doing it. If anything that people do out there is working, keep doing. Now, if you're doing some BAT protocols and after 18 months, it's getting a little bit better, that doesn't mean it's working, guys. All right? I can't tell you how many people, how many emails I get that are like, I've been working on it for 4 years. 4 years? Your dog's going to be dead by the time it gets it. So, you know, yes, some stuff does take longer, but most things just don't. You know, you can get it in days and weeks, maybe months, but, you know, I mean, hardcore aggression, who knows? But some high-level anxiety, who knows? But usually, like, I mean, I can't say how many people have been trying to get their dog to walk for years. I'm like, geez. Next.
Karen, working on place currently. My dog is starting to understand, but will sometimes let out a whine or two during place. Do I correct the whining?
A whine or two? What, one whine, two whine, over how many hours? 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours? Eh, pick your battles. What's the big deal? What's a whine here or there? Next.
Angela, how would I train a pit mix with a collapsing trachea?
Angela, so the breed doesn't matter. So the question is, how would I train a dog with a collapsed trachea. So historically, depends on how much damage is there. It's a little bit down lower. Can the collar be up higher? So if it can't, I would start out doing all clicker food training. We have to figure out some way to do, you know, also depends on what your level of, first of all, what's the behavior? If you, what's the dog? Is it a dog killer? Is it a human biter? At that point, I'm like, well, if it's a human biter, I'm not really concerned. You know, I got to be like, pick my battles here. It's like, okay, well, what are we going to do here? What's the priorities? To me, not getting people bit is a priority. But for basic obedience, you can do all food clicker protocols. Remote collar, you can actually put into a harness if you want to. You can actually attach the remote collar up higher. There's no pressure. You don't attach leashes to remote collars. They are fine with dogs with collapsed tracheas. You can do that as well. But it all depends on what you're trying to train, The cool thing is that most collars, even on a large breed dog, there's minimal to no pressure on the neck, especially if you do remote collar training. Next.
Top chat.
Everybody knows. $10. Ruben. Hey, Ruben Senior. Thank you so much. No question. Next.
Patrick. Hey, guys.
Hello.
Amanda. When applying.
Oh, that's it. Hey, guys. Hey, Patrick.
Is that the Patrick with the bonkers from last week?
Yeah, it's Patrick. He's got his whole lineup of bonkers. He built a shelf over the week.
A video about you.
Did a craft project.
Amanda, when applying a Punisher with e-collar for bad behavior, how fast do you go up in level until the dog responds? My dog got out the front door and I had to go up 4 levels before she responded.
I mean, train for it. To me, I'd go up to the highest level. It's life or death. I would start by training thresholds so your dog doesn't do that again, hopefully. But they're dogs. They make mistakes. So to me, if I have a dog running out the front door and it knows recall on a high level, I'm not going to go up 1 level at a time. It sounds like you've got maybe a sport dog or a Garmin or something like that. It sounds like you don't have a dog tra or you don't have a e-collar because it wouldn't be 1 level at a time, wouldn't be practical. I hope you're not going up by 1 level if it's an e-collar technology one, because you'd want to dial up really quick. To me, I would dial up really, 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 really quick. But practice for that. Practice for those emergencies. Everybody needs to practice recall in drive at the highest level to know what your dog is going to do, and you do it with a long line and you do it in a controlled area. Next.
Melissa says, remember everyone, hit the subscribe button and tap the bell to get notifications for Jeff's videos.
Oh yeah, hit the subscribe button.
Yep.
So yeah, Melissa wants to make sure people like keep coming back. Next.
Solimar, how to properly train dog to ignore other dogs?
That's a really good question. So you've often heard me say I'm not a big fan of dogs meeting people on walks and dogs on walks. That's the start. I'm not a big fan of that. Number one, if you want to socialize your dog, that's fine, but on the walk is not socialization. So become everything to your dog. Become everything to your dog. So when it's almost the same training we do for leash reactivity, where we want dogs to just not pay attention to other dogs. We don't want dogs to even acknowledge them. Pretend the dog is off leash. So a lot of times what happens is dogs are on a leash, and what they'll do is the dog maybe pulls gently towards it, and we're just out muscling the dog. But if that dog was off leash, it would have already crossed the street. So I don't want the dog to just physically ignore the dog. I want the dog to mentally ignore the dog. So how do you do that? Through proper obedience training, but then also have a policy of you don't meet dogs on walks. And you don't get to run up to dogs usually, you know, during play. We can have structured play in a small social group with dogs that I know, but your average dog that it sees, I want them to ignore it. And then just become everything to your dog. Just become a selfish dog owner. Next.
Becca, also, dog doesn't live with kids, so haven't had much opportunity to work on his reactivity. I was warned of it from rescue when we got him.
So you just, Becca, you got to find a playground or a school and just make sure there's a fence in between and start at a little bit of a distance and then just work your way in. Next. And we have a school right across the street from us. It works out great. Then we have Angelo. Next.
Hey, dog.
Hold on a second. What? Okay, they know how to get in.
Okay.
Thanks. Yep. Wait, hold on. Let me just check. Okay. Next.
Ready? Hey, yep. Dog. What are some indications that I've overcorrected, same as undercorrecting?
Overcorrected usually means the dog freaks out, but the dog can also freak out in an undercorrection. But overcorrection, I think most people are not overcorrecting. I mean, historically, less than like single digits of people are over. Most people undercorrect their dogs. So I've only met one person I've had to say, hey, take it easy. And also, what are we talking about? I need some more context. Like what it is, what did you correct for? What did you correct for next?
Caitlin, when correcting dog, he nips back towards his collar. Suggestions?
Yeah, that's common. They just do that because that's where the stim is coming from. So we can see if it plays out. You can see if it plays out. You can also, what you can do is you can get, if you've ever seen a lot of working dogs, some sport dogs, they use double collars. They'll use a double collar. It's not to get twice the shock. It's to get a more even, stim. But then also what happens with a lot of dogs, you can also try going a little bit lower, but then you also get your sensitive dogs. Most dogs after a while just work through that. They just work through it. Next.
Emily, I think that's a new top chat. Yeah.
$5. Yep. Sorry for all the questions tonight. You are the best and the reason I've been able to keep my dog and my sanity. I can't thank you enough. Amanda, you're welcome. Nice. Thanks. It's okay. Do this Q&A. If you become a pain in the ass, we'll tell you to shut up. Next.
Don't say we. You will. Yeah. Emily, trainer had us wear a dummy collar with e-collar for when in situations dog can't wear the e-collar. Obedience comes in therapy dog work. Not sure if this is necessary, not competing at this time.
I don't know, Emily. I mean, if your trainer told you to do it, I mean, I don't know how the dog was trained and if you trust your trainer, listen to your trainer. I mean, it doesn't sound that far-fetched. That'd be like, what the fuck are you thinking? Like, you know what I mean? It's just like, it's not unreasonable. They make dummy collars for a reason. For an obedience competition, I mean, do they let you therapy dog work? The thing is, though, like, why don't you just put a real collar on the dog? So if they say, if you're putting a dummy collar, I know what a dummy collar is. It's a collar with no electronics in it. But if it's because you can't have a remote collar on the dog, well, then how about if you just shut your remote collar off and just tell people it's a dummy collar? Or how about, like, put a piece of black tape over the flashing light and say, it's not real. I mean, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know how to answer that. I mean, okay. Ask your trainer why. Ask your trainer why. Next. I wouldn't say don't do that because he or she might have a good reason why you're doing it. Next.
The dedicated dog. Do you know of any shelters in your area that are okay with use of tools, looking to partner with one for experience with training more dogs, but I'm having trouble finding one that isn't pure positive. I am local to you.
That's a really good question. The dedicated dog. You could talk to the folks down in, South Kingston, I think. North Kingston. North Kingston. There are some rescues. There's some rescues that you're better off with a rescue. There are some rescues in New England that are tool friendly. Next.
Karen, how does a slip lead differ from a dominant dog collar? Do they function differently other than a clasp? They appear similar. Thanks.
They're much different. A slip lead is like a long piece of rope, technically. A dominant dog collar, the way a dominant dog collar goes on the dog is in a slip lead, your slip lead goes over the dog's head. A dominant dog collar, the reason why there's a clasp is because it's too small to go over the dog's head. That's the idea of it. If you don't know what a dominant dog collar is, go to Learburg.com and just look it up, or just look up dominant dog collar. It has to be unclipped. There's a floating ring. It goes around the dog's neck. It gets clipped in. The only part that's showing, instead of like the long leash of a slip lead, the only part that's showing is this tiny little tab, maybe 1 to 2 inches. So when you attach the leash to that, when you want to engage that collar, which cuts off the dog's oxygen and blood flow, it's just a little bit of this. So it's very different. It's very different. Next.
One Purpose. Good evening, J&J.
Hey, how are you? Good evening.
Grant Noble, what are your potty training time and crate per month of age ratio again?
Oh, I don't have a rate. Go. That's an online question, Grant. I'm not trying to blow you off, Grant. Go online. There's a recipe for that. I don't know. I don't know off the top. I don't have a time frame. I wing it, but there's an actual time frame. Next.
Amanda, training place, which she learned quickly. When she tried breaking, I corrected with e-collar. After that, she tried breaking one more time, which I corrected again, and she went back.
Cool. Awesome.
After that, she panted and drooled anxiously for almost an hour. Will this get better with time, or should I correct?
It'll get better with time. Next.
Michelle, my four-month pit cross puppy is on his third training place. The last two were idiots. Comments from everyone on how calm my puppy is. He knows place and lays still, but he does whine. Can't bonk in class.
He's doing well, though. Mm-hmm. Yeah, awesome. Good. Next.
Hey, dog. Trainer taught us heel with my dog's ear at my knee. My dog is reactive, whines now, not lunging or barking. Important to retrain him to have full head behind my leg.
No, I mean, you could if you want to, but it shouldn't be that hard. You just got to move him back a little bit. Next.
Oh, Michelle's was a two-part question. She said, Can't bonk in class. Any ideas how to stop that? He's excited about the other puppies.
Yeah. Ask your trainer. Go to your trainer and say, help me. I need help. My dog's excited. What do I do? I always suggest people do that. You're paying them for a service. Ask them, how do I stop all this excitement? How do I stop all this excitement? You absolutely can't bonk in class. So can you give a leash correction? Can you give a foot tap? Can you do a finger poke? Can you bonk outside the classroom and then walk in and start the class? Can you use a remote collar? They're going to probably want you to redirect, but just ask for help. Ask them for help. Next.
Terry, where can I purchase the choke collars that you use?
Terry, just for full clarification, I have never and will never use a choke collar. We don't use choke collars. There's a humongous difference. So we use prong collars, and I want to make sure that's specified, because I want to make sure the information that we get out there is correct. So a prong collar is nothing like a choke collar. You can get them on our website. You can get them on Amazon. If you want to save money, go to Amazon. If you want to pay a little bit more, you go to our website and you want to look for Herm Sprenger. Go to our website, see what we have. Now, Amazon, unfortunately, they don't know this though, because they're not in the prong collar business. They're selling knockoff ones, not on purpose. I know they're not on purpose, but there's a bunch of knockoff ones out there. They are different. The picture is the same because they're using the same stock photo, but they're different, but you'll save money. Even if you get the real ones from them, they're still cheaper because it's Amazon. Next.
Melissa said, Terry, the prong collars Jeff uses are available here. She posted the website.
Oh, awesome. Thank you.
Bob, do you believe dogs actually go kennel crazy, or is it just a dog with high anxiety and kennel staffers don't know how to assess dog behavior?
I think more of number two than number one. I mean, a dog in a shelter long enough, I mean, it ain't the best fucking life. So next.
Melissa posted the link to the What Would Jeff Do merchandise.
Yeah, we got merch, guys. Go to our store. You get t-shirts now. You get pop sockets. Next.
Hey, dog. Had my dog calm and in place during Thanksgiving. It was interesting how many people thought he was in jail and felt I was being unfair to him. So crazy.
So none of those people have ever been in jail before. None of them have been in jail before, ever. And you know what you can do? Tell them. I'll tell you what, you want a really nice thing to do for this Thanksgiving is to go down to your local shelter and get a dog, and you can do any fucking thing you want with that dog that you want to. Okay? Except for bring it back. You got to keep that dog. And where were their dogs? But this concept that dogs are, like, here's a great example. You ready? Sorry for everybody that are on my sound platforms, my voice platforms. I'm picking up the video camera right now. And any of my visually impaired people, because we actually have a lot of folks that are blind that listen to the show, I'm holding up my video camera right now and I'm pointing it, text my Malinois, and then girl, who's a German Shepherd, and then Kira. And they're all lying down on dog beds on the floor next to me, all in the horse position. They will be here for 3 hours. That's mean. That's in jail. What else should they be doing in my office? Like, what else should they be doing? Just running around free, you know, running around free. So first of all, I don't give a shit. So I keep looking at my phone. But we have a guest that's running late to check in, and we're an Airbnb host. So I've got one here in Providence, two down in Florida. I run the one in Providence. So it's like, I got to make sure that they get good service next. So stop giving a shit what people think, you know, take a fucking turkey stick and shove it up their ass. Next.
That'll blow me well. Sal, hello. Hope you guys had a great Christmas. I have an 8-month-old now. When I correct her with the mini educator, she stops and knows she did wrong. Unless she is in drive, then she ignores. What would Jeff do?
Sal, you got a mal. Okay? Sal with a mal. All right? So here's a great example. Are you ready? Text. The mal that I just showed you right here. If I corrected that dog inside the house for basic obedience on anything less than a 10, he would go, okay, no problem. On a walk, if he sees a squirrel, sees a squirrel, he shakes off 100.
It's true.
100. He just shakes it off and goes, still looking at you, squirrel. How you doing? And I'm like, fuck you. Fuck you. Fuck you. And he's like, did you say something, Jeff? Hey, what's up, beautiful? How you doing? You're looking really good up in that tree, that little bushy tail. Okay? It's a Malinois. Get ready. Got it? Get ready. You need to learn how to work your dog and drive. Got it? Find yourself a sport dog trainer. Find yourself a sport dog trainer, but also do family pet dog training. Come to me for the family pet dog training. Talk to your sport dog trainer, but definitely get your dog into some bite sports. Next. Oh, David Smith.
Oh, you just saw that before I even did.
I've been lazy with turning with holiday, rocking out, chasing tail a lot. Oh, stop that. Not enough mental stim. I'll be back to schedule soon, but do I correct? Yes, you don't need mental stimulation. Remote collar for OCD type behavior. Yeah, don't let that get out of hand. Next.
Vicky, hello. My 6-month-old German Shepherd growls when my smaller dogs walk by her when she is on place and in the crate. What's the proper way to handle?
If they're just walking by minding their own business, that would be no and correct. So you have to figure out what your punisher is. You can use a bonker. Bonker's a wrapped up towel. You can use a remote collar. So if they were just walking by minding their own business, that's not acceptable. So it's a big difference between that and going up to the dog. Next.
Miss M, what to use for training with food if dog is raw fed?
That's a really good question. Do you want to answer a question tonight, Joelle? They make get some dehydrated raw. You actually can get yourself a small food dehydrator, $24.99 on Amazon. It's white. It's got four trays that go around like that. And you can actually take a bunch of food, grind it up if you want to, spread it out, and then dry it, and then break it up, put it in your treat pouch. Next.
Amanda, do you have any opinion, suggestion on a chew toy?
Do I have an opinion?
A chew toy?
I got no fucking opinions.
Are you done?
Sorry.
Do you have an opinion or suggestion on a chew toy or bone for dogs? My dog loves to chew, but haven't found anything she can't destroy. Tried Kong, bones, antlers. She has no interest in antlers.
So, I mean, the problem is if you get like a femur bone, which is what I would use, you actually break your dog's teeth.
We're into that. It's a bone. Yeah. His mom. He does not get weight bearing bones.
Yeah.
Anymore.
You can break your dog's teeth. I mean, here's a good example. This is really funny. My dogs like to chew as well. If I give them something to chew, if I don't give them something to chew, they don't chew. Weird, isn't it? So, but does your average adult dog need something to always be chewing on? Like, I guess my dogs to be chewing a bone right now, but they don't need to because I've told them to just lie down and relax. But I'm not against chew toys. So I don't really have a suggestion on like the best chew. I would say, yeah, you do a weight-bearing bone of an animal. Next.
Maxicina, I have my bonker made. Next, I will use it.
Step two is important. Don't have analysis paralysis there, Maxicina. Next.
It's not done yet. Hope it goes well. Somewhat afraid of what dog's reaction will be. He can be a good dog, but I need to work on some issues. Hope to come to Vegas.
Maxicina, come to Vegas. Come on.
That's gonna be a good one.
We're doing this. This week will be, so we're going to be doing this live in Vegas. We're going to be doing a 3-hour Q&A with the audience in Vegas. And then we're doing my seminar in Vegas. We're doing a private dinner out with me in Vegas. And we might even be doing a breakfast with Joelle in Vegas. So who knows?
Wait, I don't get to come to dinner?
Yeah, you're going to come to dinner too. I'm not going to your breakfast.
It's going to be breakfast with Joelle?
Breakfast with Joelle, yeah. Yeah.
Gone.
Yeah.
All right.
I'll still be at the fucking blackjack table.
I'll play blackjack with you.
Hold on. Yeah. There's a $4.99 top chat. Hey, dog. Hey, dog. Next.
Paige, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, dog. Family member's dog whines incessantly while in place. E-collar correct at different levels. Bronx scares him off place. No health issues. Nothing helps. What to do? The whining drives me nuts. Oh,
God, I know. We had a dog recently. We couldn't stop the whining. Couldn't do it. Tried everything. This is like one dog this year. You know, there's always that dog. But what I would do is I'd be like, whenever it comes to a whiner, I'm like, what's the rest of the day look like? Now, the bonking and jumping off place, if he was on a tie back, he couldn't do that. So that might be a little hack there for you. So, but what's the rest of the day look like? How much structure is in the rest of the day? That's what I would look at. That's what I would address first. But boy, man, we deal with a lot of whining dogs. Trust me. We get a lot of them. But we had one. So what did we do? We did a lot of stuff. We still trained the dog up. Still did great. But that dog whined until the day it left. Next.
Blair, for sit down, heel in place, is it better to use momentary or constant stim?
Depends on how you decide to train. During us with the learning phase, we use continuous on, continuous off. And then during the punishment phase, we do momentary. Next.
Kaylee J., family kept asking why I didn't bring my dog to Christmas dinner. And honestly, their 550-plus-pound chaotic dogs weren't what I wanted my dog to be around, Christ, since he still struggles with staying calm.
All right.
Good place. I made the choice that was better for my dog, and I'm so glad I did. He would have been an insane, whining mess if I had brought him. It was chaos.
Good, Kaylee J. Proud of you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Next.
CJ says, love that video too.
Nice.
Rick Maloney. At early stages, off-leash with e-collar, can't get one of my dogs to play or run free when off-leash away from home.
Huh. Well, put him in a down and walk away and call him to you. Do that. Or see if you can do some engagement activities, like, you know, tug or chuck it or something like that. Next.
David Smith. I've always taught heel by making random turns in yard or park, but Jeff 360 is awesome for sidewalks or anywhere. Listen to Jeff. You mean 180?
The 180, Jeff. The 180. David, cut it in half, buddy. Don't multiply me by two. Nobody needs that.
Jeff size two. Yep. Daily, the service pit. Any advice for someone who's never had a puppy?
Yeah, don't get one.
Hey.
There's a little bit of truth to that.
Little.
There's a little bit of truth to that. Puppies are difficult. Puppies are very, very difficult. What I would do is I would get yourself a good puppy book. The Monks of Newskeet, believe it or not, Caesar Milan makes a good puppy book too. And there's a couple of good journals that are really, really good as well. Massive amounts of structure. If it's going to end up being a large breed dog, watch the picking up. Everything we do is food driven at the beginning. So it's all food and marker stuff. We start training from day one. Crate the dog. You know, make sure you're crating the dog. When you're not home, when you're not there, put the dog on a tight schedule and have structure for everything. Next.
Hey, dog, you are amazing. Thank you. T3, here I come.
Awesome. Sign up for California. Next.
Vincent. Every time my dog has crap, she gets aggressive and bites my wrists. 1 year old.
So I would probably definitely don't give your dog some, what's that stuff called that makes the dog poop more? I was trying to think of something to say.
I don't know. Efflax or something like that.
It's probably not corrected to the crapping. Your dog is probably just signaling that maybe it has to go outside, and that's how it tells you it has to go outside. You correct it for that and then know your dog's schedule. So I actually don't, my dogs actually don't have a signal to go outside. I just know their schedule. I just put them on a schedule and they go outside and then they go to the bathroom. So yeah, we got a
top chat.
California $5, California, Canada $5. You guys are the best. Sorry, it's Canadian $5. I didn't know how to change the currency. Hey man, we'll take Canadian money. Don't worry. They'll still let me in the country. You know, I've been kicked, not kicked out. I've been refused entry twice into Canada.
Yeah, I believe it.
I know. And it's not even because of DUI. Because DUI, they don't let you in for, I think, 8 years. Next.
Gabriel, so sorry about Ronan. Almost cried when I heard the news.
Yeah, I did cry.
Me too.
Next. It sucks.
Laura, again, 5-month-old GSE used to be great in the car, but now he whines and cries. Would you use an e-collar to correct this?
I would. And I put him in a down, and I put him in a crate and lots of structure. But definitely, the dog goes through stages. Okay, remember, and your 5-month-old dog is not going to be your 7-month-old dog. And your 7-month-old dog is not going to be your 9-month-old dog. And you're not like, keep going and going and going. So you're just going through stages. They're dogs, and they're always evolving. They're always like, if somebody drops off a five-month-old dog to us for a 5-week boarding train, even if we didn't do any training, they'd get a different dog back. Cause it's 6 weeks, 1 month. It's a different dog. Like they evolve so much in that period of time. Next.
$400 hand cart. Best age to start using remote collar for correction.
Well, we do remote collar training at 14 weeks old because it's all paired with food and it's just a little bit of a marker, but it's not used for corrections. Depends what the dog is doing. I mean, would I use it on a 5-month-old dog? Yeah, I guess if it was eating poop and getting in the trash and stuff, I would. Because a 5-month-old dog has a little bit more free roaming. So, but I wouldn't use it for like high-level corrections for a lot of stuff because a bonker would be just fine. Next.
Paige, what is your outlook on dogs barking, and is it always necessary to train them not to bark?
I mean, I'm a family pet dog trainer. Most people don't want their dogs to bark. I mean, barking, I mean, I don't know if there's anybody else out there, but I find barking annoying. So I've got an outside perimeter dog, and he barked. I mean, he might have, I don't know if he barked when we were already on the air, but if somebody comes on our property, he barks, but I can't imagine a dog barking all day. And we've got a neighbor whose dog barks all day and it's annoying as fuck. I mean, I don't know of anybody that wants a dog to be barking all the time. When I'm in my RV, I travel in my RV a lot. If I'm in the RV during the day driving, my dogs cannot bark. Like if I'm at a gas station or if I'm at a truck stop or wherever, if I'm out of the RV, they can bark all they want. At night, they're allowed to bark in certain situations because RVers we're common targets. We park in Walmart parking lots and truck stops and rest stops and some secluded areas and hotel parking lots. There is a level of barking that is acceptable, depends on the situation. But frankly, barking is annoying. I mean, it just is. Oh, that's what dogs are supposed to do. Yeah, but they also shit where they are. But they happen to be in our house. So no, this whole don't let a dog be a dog. They're like, we are domesticating them, you know, we are domesticating them. Next.
Laura, thanks for all your great advice. You've motivated me to purchase a prong and e-collar.
Cool. Awesome. Next.
Mario, Feliz Navidad to all of you.
Oh, Feliz Navidad to you.
I see that the pictures behind are not leveled again. Are you trying to drive someone crazy before New Year's? They're like beyond crooked.
Okay.
Right,
not just before New Year's. Those pictures are.
And did you move them? Isn't Kira's always on that side?
No. Mario, they're always crooked. All right? They're always crooked. Next.
Ruben, thanks for all the advice you provide. My dog Lilo really appreciates it.
Awesome.
Montana.
Hey, Montana. What's up,
MT? Hey, guys. Our Educator 302 is the best, so thanks for the recommendations and videos on how to use it. FYI, no goddamn snow in Kalispell, Montana.
Wow.
WTF. Have a great New Year, Joelle and Jeff.
Wow. You have a good New Year, too. Holy shit.
No snow?
Man, that's like so on Montana of it. Next.
Ruben, are you planning to visit Oahu in the future?
I've been to Maui.
Ooh.
So Ruben, yeah, give me a location out there and I'll do a seminar. I can drum up enough business. The problem is it's hard getting dogs for inter-island there. So I probably would want to do one on the big island. You know, I probably would do one on the big island, but I'd be open to it. I've got enough contacts in Hawaii. Next.
Bailey, the service pit. Any advice for someone who's never had a puppy? Puppy will be 8 weeks old.
I think they already asked. You already asked that question.
I think so.
Yep. Too. I answered it. Yep. Next.
Amy, feral rescue, 6 months old.
Did you see Charlie and me?
It was retracted.
Nope. The one above it.
No, C has I don't have one above it.
Oh, C has one major trigger point on walks, three yappers behind a fence, took two leash pops and walked back and forth in front of them about 10 times. He did a sit. He sat with his head under my coat, but sat quietly. Awesome. You don't have that one?
No, look.
Oh, nothing. Yeah. Look at that.
Strange. Amy, feral rescue, 6 months old, shut down, but will walk quietly on leash, one-on-one with me. But with the other dog, she's happier and plays well, but will bite me if I correct any dog and when I kennel her up. Any tips?
Okay. If it's truly a feral dog, I've owned a feral dog. I trained it one thing, recall. And then I let it run with my dogs. And I did not domesticate it. I've worked with packs of true feral dogs. There's always going to be a ceiling on most dogs. A feral dog, there's a limited ceiling that you're going to get. The fact that it does better with dogs than humans is absolutely the truth. That's why I let my feral dog just run with dogs and it had a fantastic life. Like, ideally, it should live with dogs and not humans, but in a controlled environment. So, but if you're going to try to domesticate this dog, what you're going to do is you have to put that dog on a tie back and you have to work your other dogs and that other dog can't respond. And if they try and you want to work on kennel up commands, go in the crate, out of the crate, in the crate, out of the crate, any nonsense, treat it like any other dog. But I just want folks to know, if you guys are going to be getting these feral dogs, truly feral dogs, be prepared for a possible lifelong struggle with these dogs. And I just talked to somebody yesterday, and she was thinking about getting a feral dog. And when we got into the discussion, she told me the dog lived on a ranch and it ran with another dog. And I'm like, and it's happy and it could stay there. Leave it there. Let it be. Let it be. That's an incredible life for that dog. Living with you, no matter how good of a dog owner you are, no matter how long, this isn't addressed to you at all, Amy, and all these are different conversations. Sometimes people take things personally, like, oh my God, Jeff's attacking me. I don't attack anybody. Just follow my content. But like, let some of these dogs be dogs. And what I mean by that is they're not made for humans. They're not family pets. They're not family pet quality. So just like some dogs are not working dog quality, some dogs are actually not family pet quality. And that goes both ways. Some of these intense working dogs don't make good family pets, but some of these other dogs, they don't make family pets at all. They're made for literally like, oh, you've got a farm, let them run. And that doesn't mean a German Shepherd with too much energy. Like, people use that bullshit excuse. He needs a farm with more property. No, he doesn't. He needs a firmer owner. But I'm talking about a feral animal. So, but if you're going to domesticate this dog, it's going to be a struggle, which is fine. But a punisher is a punisher for going after you. Next. But I've seen some feral dogs will fight to the death. They go into defense and they don't care. Next.
$4.99 top chat.
Really?
Anastasia, it just didn't come up.
Yep, go ahead.
Does it make a huge difference in training a dog, getting the dog at 9 months old from a shelter versus getting the dog as a puppy from a breeder?
It's a crapshoot either way. It's a crapshoot either way. I think if you don't have a lot of puppy raising experience, you might be better off with a 9 month old dog from the shelter, as long as it's not human and dog aggressive. But your dog from the breeder could become human and dog aggressive if you don't know what you're doing. And that doesn't mean being mean to it. I still got the stuffy nose.
I know. It's like
But everybody's like, oh, the dog was aggressive because it was abused. Nope. The dog was aggressive because it got too much love and affection and no consequences. I can say that with confidence. That's the number one reason why dogs are aggressive, because they were never held accountable for their actions. Absolutely. That's why dogs are aggressive. Next.
Do you need to blow your nose?
No.
Okay. Thanks. Solimar. My pup is 1 year old and had a bit of anxiety, and I would love to find a way to bring her confidence back up. Any advice?
Yeah, if you're struggling with anxiety, okay, I can appreciate that. Do confidence building things. Generally, obedience training is great, but then also work on all of your confidence building stuff. What does that consist of? Do some agility training, some trick training. Things like go up on things, go under things, go through things. You know, do things like that. Engagement with play. Introduce your dog to as many different environmentals as you can. Sounds, climates, things. You know, touching. You know, surfaces, things like that. Next.
Patrick, this guy cracks me up. He says, LOL, yep, I'll have Christmas theme bonkers, New Year's, Easter, seasonal. I love you guys. I'm glad everyone got a good laugh.
Good. Patrick, I love you too.
That's awesome.
Patrick, if you go to Walmart right now, you go to Walmart, buddy, all the Christmas stuff is half price. You know they got kitchen towels. You know they got bath towels there with Christmas themes on them. They might even have some leftover Halloween stuff. Next.
Vega. The dog's kennel is in a tight spot, so like confined, where there's only one opening. Could it be that he feels concerned or confined, which is why he growls?
It could be. Corner? Yeah, it could be. There's a lot of different variables. Next.
Skincare Moxie. I'm trying to stop my dog from peeing and pooping on the carpet. She sleeps in my bed. I have to kennel her up for 8 to 10 hours for work. Is this too much? I love you, dude. Love your goatee. Yeah.
Okay. I don't think there's a goatee. Maybe that's all you can see.
That's the first thing you comment on.
So I started not shaving, and all of a sudden somebody commented on it. Well, Linda was like, that looks good on you. And I'm like, huh. And now some of the super fan groupies are like, geez, Jeff, that's looking pretty good. I'm almost 53. I'm vain. I'll take the fucking attention from the ladies. But thank you. So I'm going to leave it for now and see where it goes. So what I would do is this is, if you're not crating your dog at work, I'm sorry, if you're at work and you're not crating your dog and it's pissing and pooing on the carpeting, then like, what else do you do? You got to crate the dog. I don't know how to stop pee and pooing on carpeting with a dog that's free roaming other than to crate it and then crate train it. But that's 8 to 10 hours is a long time to leave a dog unattended. It's a really long time. So you have to find a daycare or find a dog walker or find a pet sitter to come in halfway through. Next.
Vega, to continue with the growling issue, my dog has resource guarding issues. Could it be because he is insecure? How can I fix that?
Not necessarily. So resource guarding, that's a quick fix with a remote collar. I've got a video on the out command. I teach that with food. Watch the video. Next.
Allie Aussie, if you are training the dog to ignore environmentals such as dogs on a walk, I am working towards daycare once a week. Am I being unrealistic with this goal?
No, I mean, that could be you don't need to do daycare. I mean, your dog might do better in daycare because it's off leash away from you. We have a lot of dogs that do fine off leash in a daycare setting, but on a leash where the owners don't do well. Next.
Christine, does it matter where the dog is crated? For example, master bedroom upstairs versus downstairs in a separate room?
Get the dog out of your bedroom. Next.
Solimar, my dog has a little anxiety and is a bit reactive when dogs are nearby. By the way, my pup is a service dog in training. I love all your videos and all of your advice. It's perfect. Can you be my trainer? Ha ha.
Sure. I'm hired help. I mean, people fly me out to them. It's not cheap. This is a lot cheaper to do it this way. Next.
Lindsay, as a mom of 3 toddlers, I wish I could lay down in the place command for 3 hours. It sounds amazing. It isn't jail. LOL.
Lindsay, you're a fucking trooper, man. Thank you.
Russ, so with a dog like Tex who shakes 100 off, how would you correct?
Well, he stays in heel, so I'm not making it a priority. His off-leash recall is great. So I'm not making it a priority. So guess what I do? I'm like, as long as he stays in heel, he looks at squirrels, he blows up. I did it just to be like, holy shit, look at the fucking him. I didn't move. It didn't bother me. Next.
Jenna. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. Dog, leash, reactive dog on prong and e-collar. He likes to look behind him when out on walks. Yeah. Should I correct his behavior? If so, how?
I would. You correct it just with a remote and then teach him. You teach him to look towards you. So stop that. And then you end up cueing him to that when you hit the stem, he looks up at you. And then what he's going to want to do by default is he's just paranoid. Something's behind him. A lot of dogs do that. And then what he'll do is he'll end up looking up at you. Next.
Michelle, oh my God, my guy blew me off over a squirrel today. It's 75. Not a male, but that made me laugh.
Yeah, I've had dogs blow me off on dog tread 1900s at 127. My own personal dog, Uma, she chased a deer. Probably she's been dead for 2 years. 2 years, she lived till 12. So 12 years ago, she blew me off on a dog trail 127 chasing a deer, screaming the whole way. She didn't give a shit. Yeah. Next.
Sammy.
Guys, dogs go through underground fences. Remember that. Next.
Sammy Shipman. Mozart loves bully sticks.
Look up bully sticks and find out. I think there's all kinds of crap in them, the coating in them. Look them up, though, how good they are for dogs or bad they are for dogs.
Make your own. Just go buy some bull penis.
That's, you could make your own. Yep. You could make your own. Yep.
Emily, thanks for all the info. Love your videos and giving me so much motivation. Joelle, where are the hats in the merch shop for us dirty hair girls? I know. We could get some hats going.
We can get hats, actually.
Oh, yeah.
We can get them. They have them.
Let's do it.
Yeah, they would be embroidered. All right. Look, go on. The, go talk to Amanda.
Okay. Yep. Work on it, Emily.
Next. But they're not going to be the ones that like you wear.
Yeah, it's not going to be beanies. It's yeah. Like a baseball hat.
No. There's that too. There's baseball hats, but there's a beanie, but not the one that has the
cuff.
Not the cuff. It's literally just the one that it's like a beanie. It's the real beanie. Interesting. Yeah, they've got two caps, but they have absolutely. They definitely we can definitely do what would Jeff do? Baseball caps, black with white embroidery. Absolutely. Next.
David Smith, I've tried having butchers split the beef bones with success. They can get to marrow easier and don't seem to use as much bite pressure.
Nice.
Gooksters, great job with the business. I feel so happy for you. P.S. The beard looks great on you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Kaylin, hoping to come to the seminar in Rhode Island in the spring. Thank you for laughs and all of your info.
Kaylin, get your fucking ass here. It's coming up in March. Is that spring officially?
March?
Is March spring?
21st.
Is that spring? Mm-hmm. Oh, it is spring. Get here in the spring.
It snows here in the spring though. Snows through like May.
All right. We'll see you soon. Next.
David Smith, breakfast with Joelle. Hell yeah.
You got to come to Vegas.
Go.
You
gotta go, come David. You got to come to breakfast. Vegas. Christine, you need to write your own book if you haven't already.
No, if I have, I would have been pushing it on you guys already. No, I need a ghostwriter first. Next.
David Smith, yeah, tripped when I did the 360 by mistake. This guy is full of jokes. David, I love it.
David, it's like people thought you were probably practicing out for the Nutcracker.
he paid $1.99. He said tax for stupid typo. David, you're awesome. Come to breakfast. All right, Gabriel. Joelle, you look very pretty tonight. Thanks, Gabriel.
Oh, that's so nice, so Gabe. Sweet.
Amanda, how do you restrict free roaming in the house? Always keep a leash on, gates, or something else. I assume you would use the place command once they learn it, but wondering before they are consistent.
But they're pretty good. Yeah. So I'm not against gates, but gates are a pain in the ass. You know, we have some gates at work. It's probably more for because there's a lot of untrained dogs there. Most of our dogs jump over gates, so it doesn't really matter. Mm. If a dog's not underneath voice control, it should have a leash on it. Next.
Page Burner.
And utilize your crate.
Next. She donated $1.99 and said, do you think paying for a trainer is always necessary?
No, not at all. I mean, how many people, you know, show of hands, how many people here have trained their own dogs on my page? A ton of people train their own dogs through our free content. Absolutely not. Nope. And that's how, by the way, guys, that's how I make a living. I need people to hire me. Next.
Skyblaze 184 King. I recently got my Cane Corso puppy's ears cropped and I've been getting a lot of backlash. What do you think about ear crops and people commenting on it while we walk?
Well, it doesn't make a difference what I think because I'm going to tell you to stop giving a fuck what other people think. So it doesn't matter what I think, but stop giving a fuck what other people think. Mm. All right. So it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to me at all. So, you know, it's like, let's see, slicing open your dog and taking out its reproductive system. Huh. Now that's a good choice. I'm not against spay and neuter though, but it's like, you don't get into discussions. You don't get into arguments. You don't say anything. You just move on your way. All right. Anybody that says something to you unsolicited is a rude asshole. It's as simple as that. So people aren't making comments. Rude assholes are making comments. They're being rude to you. Nice people don't make comments about other people's dogs. Nice people don't make comments in general about things that are not solicited or not in a discussion platform. They're being rude. So don't worry about it. Next.
Salomar, I live in Florida. You have any seminars coming down south?
Yeah, I do. I've got one coming up in February. Get your ass down there.
In Florida.
In Florida, yeah. JeffGellmanSeminars.com. It's the 2nd of February. Next.
Anthony, should all dogs be crate trained?
I think so, because you never know when you're going to have to board your dog or take your dog to the vet. Next.
Sammy, I got the all-natural ones made from 100% grass-fed cows.
There you go, Sammy. Next.
Karen, my dog no longer guards his food when I'm near him. It's best not to try to take away his food when eating, right? Previous thoughts were to practice this with the dog. Thoughts? Thanks.
No, you could teach the dog out and take it away. But just don't. I just don't do it all the time. My dog's eating 30 seconds or less. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I can easily walk in and grab my dog's food bowl. All of our client dogs, we should be able to do that with. Teach the dog out. Teach the dog out. Next.
Anthony, should there be a place command and lay down command?
Yeah, two different things. Place command is on an object. Down is anywhere in the world on any surface. So down is actually more helpful if you go places with your dog. Place command is good for like when there's an object for the dog to go onto. So usually, historically, it's like a dog bed or a little platform where down is down. Like wherever I'm with my dogs, they lay down. Next.
Chris P says, beanies, yes, I'd buy for sure.
Cool.
Marnie Cool Dog says hello.
Oh, hey, Marnie. Haven't heard seen you for a while. Next.
The Dedicated Dog, hoping to attend T3 this year, but need to save up some money first. Will there only be one this year?
There's two in Rhode Island and one in California. Next.
That's all, and it's 9:30.
Get out of here.
Look at that.
Nice. All right, guys, let's give you a couple of little plugs. Let's give us a couple of little plugs here. First of all, go to Jeff Gellman Seminars, jeffgellmanseminars.com to see my seminar schedule. Make sure you check us out on Instagram. Check out our Instagram stories every day. You'll find out that I did a twofer today.
twofers.
I'm waiting for one of your snide comments. I guess you haven't seen it yet. Check us out on Instagram and our Instagram stories. It's a lot of fun. Facebook, there's a lot of great content. And our YouTube channel. And again, if you're not subscribed to the YouTube channel, subscribe to the YouTube channel and then turn on the notifications. And there's a lot of great content that goes up there. And obviously, we're also on Facebook. And if any of you are really, really struggling, you can also join our Patreon channel, patreon.com/solidcaninetraining. All the links are on our website of Solid Canine Training. And all the links are actually on the Instagram bio as well with a little link right there. And if any of you really need, you know, some one-on-one remote help, I do Skypes. I do a lot of Skypes every day. Those are paid. I mean, that's actually one of the ways that I actually make a living is through Skypes and seminars and actually the dog training company. But I'm always here to give out massive amounts of free content with no obligation of anything in return at all. And I want to thank you guys for everything that you do. If I don't see you before the end of the new year, hey, are we open? Are we open on New Year's Day?
Like
the company?
Like the company?
Yeah. Is it a holiday?
Jess made a schedule. I want to say it's like skeleton staff, like we did for Christmas.
Oh, do you want to do a really long What Would Jeff Do?
Sure.
Like, how many hours could you do? How many hours could you sit here?
When's New Year's Day? Next Tuesday?
Yeah, thanks. Oh, shoot, it's your day off.
I don't have any plans.
Want to do a really long one?
I'll try. I'm going to have lots of coffee and
okay. No, it'll be catered.
Snacks.
It'll be catered. It'll be catered. Literally, we'll cater it.
Can I bring my dogs?
Yes, you can bring your dogs. You bring your dogs.
It's a deal.
It'll be catered.
Feed me and give me coffee.
And we'll work out bathroom breaks. How long can you do it for?
I don't know. We'll see.
Can you do a 5-hour one?
Will we have an intermission?
No.
All right. Well, I'll see.
Maybe we'll do a 3-hour one and we'll see how it goes.
Okay.
3-hour minimum. And we'll see how it goes.
Okay.
What are you doing New Year's Eve?
I don't have any plans.
Can we do it? You want to do one? You want to do one?
As the clock strikes
12. Do you want to do one? You want to do one on, that's Monday. It's a Monday. Do you want to do one starting at our normal time, 8, and keep going?
Sure.
Want to do that instead? And you can have your dogs, and you could, and it can have breaks, and we have it catered.
Great.
Want to do that? Fine. Deal? Nice. We have shrimp cocktail. We can have, nice. We have some hors d'oeuvres here. You know. Okay?
That's fine.
All right, good. We're going to do that. So minimum of a 3-hour New Year's Eve.
People are going to tune in on New Year's Eve?
I don't know. We need a lot of, we need a shitload of questions.
Yeah. I know.
I don't think, I mean,
people, everyone might be out.
You know what? You know what?
Ringing in the new year.
You know what? I haven't gone out for New Year's Eve for,
I know,
20 years.
I know.
Let's see. My oldest kids are 28. I've been with Linda for, I think, 18 years now. Maybe we went out once. I just don't, I'm not a New Year's Eve guy.
Well, let's see what everyone's saying.
You know, I'm not a New Year's Eve guy, you know?
Allie Wynn says, get the girl sushi. Chris P says, yes, New Year's Eve show, please. All right, all right. New Year's Eve. All right, so some people want this. All right.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of people do.
Yeah, we'll do it.
Yeah.
Sammy says, I'll be there. I don't go out for New Year's Eve. All right, cool. Yeah. We'll do a New Year's Eve show.
Yeah. We'll start announcing it now. I just don't, I mean, I think it'd be fun. I think it'd be one really great last hurrah. Tell stories, laughs.
Oh, yeah, what a year.
You want to do, maybe you'll share your story.
Maybe.
You want to share your story on New Year's Eve?
Sure.
Will you share, like, a really transparent story?
Sure. I'll share my story. You guys want to hear my story?
Can I interview you?
Sure. Let's go. Go big or go home. We're going to have, like, 5 hours to talk about
this. You want to do that?
Yeah.
Oh.
Gonna be a good one.
Right to your 12 story.
How did I end up here?
That's right. And my influence. Yeah. The influence of Jeff.
Yeah, all you people who think you want to go to T3.
That's right.
You're in. That's right. It. Yeah.
Joelle's divorce number.
I don't know,
25. No, I think your divorce number.
I think
that
was 14.
Well, actually, no, I think you're. Someone, you still aren't legally divorced.
I'm technically not legally
divorced. So someone
still married.
Someone beat you to it. So somebody beat you to it while you were separated.
Wow.
Yeah.
Quick.
Yeah, they beat you to it.
Shit.
Yeah. So, all right. So I think we're gonna do that. We're gonna do it. It's a Monday night anyway. We're plan on a minimum of a. No, if we
look at all, everybody wants it. If we do,
but we have to pass it by Linda.
I was thinking that.
Yeah. Sorry, I got to pass it by my wife.
We'll just be in here making a ruckus.
Yeah, I got to pass it by Linda first. So, all right. But I think it'll work. I think we can get a free pass. We'll just have to pay her. So I just have to give her money.
Bring her snacks.
Linda, are you up?
She might come in here with a frying pan.
Yeah, she might be sleeping. All right. I'll talk to you guys later. All right. I'm really madly in love with you. When I say it, it's not a catchphrase, guys. I've got a phrase, madly in love with you. I truly am madly in love with you. All right. Take care. Talk to you guys later.